Thank you very much for coming here. I have perhaps a slightly larger audience than I am entitled to, and I'm very grateful to the weather today for having supported my talk. It's very kind of the weather to have, you know, kind of given us bad results out there so that a few more people come in here to the warmth and the dryness of the lecture hall. What I'll be talking about is an area that has been fascinating me for a number of years now. Not very long, not thousands of years. You know, I look like I'm thousands of years old. So I haven't been working on this for a thousand years. But it's an area which is at the interface of information technology and energy. So of course, you'd say, well, that's obvious. I mean, today we run energy systems using information technology, and therefore those two things interact. But my concern, the way I approached it, was the other way around. It is, what is the impact of energy on information technology? It is, how can you modify the way computers and networks, communications, information processing, how can you modify the way these things work based on energy? And how much energy do they draw? Information technology and whatnot, how much energy do they draw themselves? And it's not a matter of using information technology to control energy, but rather the opposite way around. The energy impact on information technology and the way information technology exploits energy for its own use. This tends to be an important subject, an increasingly important subject, because, and I will repeat this as I go through some of my first slides, because on the one hand, we are in a world where all of the processes that we depend upon for manufacturing, for supply chains, for transportation, and so on, all these processes are getting more and more energy efficient. Okay? And they're also better able to exploit renewable energies. Of course, around this campus, you have examples of this at CSIRO and so on. On the other hand, although all of these things are becoming more energy efficient, and they are using, in fact, to a certain extent, less energy. For instance, airplanes today are far more efficient using energy, of course. There are many more airplanes than 30 years ago, but each of the airplanes is far more efficient in transporting passengers with less energy than, you know, the equivalent airplanes might have been 20 years ago. And this results from design issues with respect to the aerodynamics. It also results from the aspects of density, so you have larger planes, and also relates to the fact that the engines are far more efficient. Okay, so we have all of this happening. At the other end, while all of these manufacturing, transportation, supply chain issues are far more energy efficient, at the ICT level, computing level, things are far more efficient. I mean, we do much more computation today per joule than we were able to do, I don't know, 15 years ago. However, we have a steadily increasing energy consumption by information technology. Okay? Now, you might ask yourself, in a normal world, in a normal society, you know, a global society, what would you expect the fraction of energy consumption to be for information technology? And then, to answer that question, you might turn to your own self, to your own body, and realize that we use 20% of our energy right here, okay, in the head and the brain. That's where we use 20% of our energy. So you'd say, well, if the world uses 20% of its energy for information technology, it's quote-unquote normal. It so happens that we have actually gone beyond that. I will show you some numbers. We have actually gone beyond that. So it starts becoming worrisome, okay? And the whole discussion will be about those issues today. So energy and quality of service, of course, there's a very easy way to make information technology non-consumptive of energy. You just turn everything off. right? When you turn everything off, you get no energy consumption, but the quality of service is zilch. I mean, basically, the response times become infinite, the throughput stays zero, and you're not getting any service at all. So you can, of course, slow things down, ration information technology, and get low energy consumption, but that doesn't make sense. So we have to find a way of building systems and managing them so that, in some sense, they are as energy efficient as possible.
So my talk will say a few things about my work environment. We will have a little bit of an overview beyond what I've just already said. I'm moving at a fairly slow pace, but I'm trying to make myself understood. And then I will touch on a certain number of different aspects which are of interest, I think. One is the relationship between energy and wireless communications. Then we will talk about energy consumption and quality of service in computer systems, okay? We may say just a few words, perhaps one, two slides, about what happens in wired networks, very important topic. It's the internet, okay, the backbone networks. We will then talk about perhaps some new ideas or new mathematical paradigms that may be used to look at these systems. And then we will deal with something which is futuristic and a lot of futuristic things. We say, oh, I'm working with long-term research, etc. I mean, that research we never heard of, right? Long-term research is sometimes infinite term. The great ideas, big, fun, kind of fantastic ideas, which never anyone never does anything with them. So one of these ideas is whether one could communicate with particles, with single particles. That carry spin. Okay, you've all heard about spin doctors. Just think of particles as spin doctors telling you stories, and that's what communicating with spins is all about. All right. So we have this kind of panoply of things we will travel around. I think the last one on the list will not be talked about, or perhaps it will. We'll see. We'll see how we go. Okay. So my work environment. I'm head of a research group inside the department, so we have about 10 academic staff, and then about 50 postdocs, researchers, perhaps a little bit more now. So that's the macroscopic thing. But within this, within this group, this larger group, my own activities are small. I have about five or six PhD students at any given instant of time, and I have typically two or three postdocs at a given instant of time. And I have a number of grants that run, typically for 3-4 years. So I'm just in a period of my existence, and this happens to many academics, where a bunch of grants is finishing, and a new set of grants are half finished, and a new set of grants are starting. So my finishing grants were about security of mobile networks, and in fact, one of the things we looked at was how security and energy. There are some interesting, for instance, you can use energy consumption as a detector of certain forms of attacks. And we've looked at another project we had was looking at cloud computing and seeing how you could manage jobs in the cloud so that you could use reduce energy consumption and also optimize quality of service and give good response times to the users. We have had an interesting project on energy harvesting. So basically what I ended up doing is developing some of the mathematical models that I'll be talking about today. A lot of the work I do tends to have some probability in it, stochastic processes, probability, and also tends to have demonstrators, building systems, and redoing real measurements. So we do those kinds of things. I hope also had a project from the Department of Defense, Ministry of Defense in the UK, its research division, and we were looking at the issue of managing energy in a military base so that you could be as efficient as possible, okay, because in remote bases you have to carry your energy on your back, right? You're carrying either huge batteries or you're carrying jerry cans of petrol or diesel to run your generator. So the energy issues is important, and so on. So we had a number of projects like that, and those are finished. Just about finished, right? You know, some of them finished in May, June. And now I have a new series of projects. One is about energy, again,
and information technology, and we're looking at how mobile networks may operate with renewable energy. We have another project which is security related, and it's about flows of health data that need to cross boundaries, natural boundaries when people travel, because people may be ill or there may be emergencies. So how do you make those things more secure? And we have a project with Huawei, a Chinese telecoms company, a global telecoms company. I think they're about $60 billion worth, US dollars worth of sales. We're looking at how you can manage, adaptively manage data center networks, networks which are inside data centers, inside large computer centers. So we have these three projects starting and some other submissions. Okay, so here's a picture which actually was one of the things that launched the whole debate about energy and information technology. And this is a picture from Gartner. Gartner is an organization that's kind of an organization that looks into the future about various things on commission. They get money and they look into the future. That's a nice job to have. So they looked at the situation in 2007 and made some predictions about 2020. Okay. Now, what's quite interesting is that these predictions, contrary to all the other ones, seem to hold. That is, the checkpoint between 2007 and 2020, which is not there yet, the checkpoint today or a couple of years ago, tells us that they were more or less right. Okay. And what they were saying was, well, 2007, they were saying, well, number one, it turns out that the CO2 impact, carbon dioxide impact, of electricity consumed for information technology was at that time equivalent to the CO2 impact of air travel, civilian air travel. Okay. So air travel, which has an obvious CO2 impact because it's burning kerosene under the air, that has the same effect, had the same effect in 2007 as had information technology. The other thing they said was this was going to more or less double. The whole phenomenon of information technology's energy consumption, and information technology consumes electrical energy. You don't burn coal directly to run our computer, so we go through electricity. So that it would kind of double up. Okay, so when you're going up, everything would kind of more or less double up. You see the tons of CO2 there, 0.83 billion tons. And there you see 1.43 billion tons. It's not quite double, but it's in that direction. They said that. And then they also said other things. They said growth 4%. And there they went wrong. Because the growth has been 5%. Okay, so the growth is quite fast. It's even above 5, according to some estimates. And they also said that the culprits, if you took information technology in general, the culprits were more or less what's in the diagram, and that's kind of true. One thing they said that surprised people at that time was that data centers are 18% of the total kind of bad guy effect. That telecoms was more significant than data centers, okay, with about 25%. And then the rest was a general purpose information technology, including your mobile phones, including the servers that are lying around, and so on. So all of that stuff. So that's what they said. And actually, all of this has been borne out in intermediate steps of analysis. So it's kind of interesting to see where we are today. Now, this thing today is admitted to be around 20%. So you have about 20% here, data centers are a bit more important, but what happens with data centers is that because they are concentrated users of electricity, highly concentrated users, when you do efficiency build-up, you can render them more efficient. Then you can say with base stations that you see there on top of buildings, okay, they are far less efficient in the way you can optimize them than data centers where you can do night-day effects, economic optimization, and of course the stakes are high because, say, a data center might be a 2 megawatt consumer electricity. So they will invest a lot of money making this as efficient as possible. So this part of the picture remains under control, and the telecoms is kind of interesting because whatever you do today in computing, you communicate, right? You turn your mobile, incidentally, your mobile devices worldwide represent less than 1% of the electricity consumption, the devices themselves, less than 1% of the electricity consumption of ICT in general. In fact, quite a bit less than 1%. So the mobile devices themselves are negligible. But all the stuff they do, they communicate with the mobile base station. The mobile base station uses up energy. This creates packet transmission into the backbone network through routers. And all of these routers and the switches and all that stuff will consume energy. Furthermore, you have another level of energy consumption in the servers that control the mobile network, plus the websites that you get into. Okay? So all of that is the energy consumer result, consumption resulting from your action with mobile device, not the mobile device itself. So that's how it goes. And telecoms acts a little bit like a VAT, value added tax. Anything you do that's going to be this 20-25% VAT due to telecoms in terms of energy consumption. Now, another interesting thing, although you might say, well, that's not too bad. It's kind of interesting. I don't know how many of you have looked at your Apple computer or whatever laptop you use and checked how much energy has been consumed to actually manufacture the device. Okay? You will notice that the manufacturing energy is 3 to 5 times the consumption. Okay? So that's why the numbers become scary. So we're not really talking about 5, 6, 7%. We're talking about 25, 30, 35, 40% energy consumption as of today for information technology, because you have to consider consumption, but you also have to consider manufacturing energy. Okay. Been long-winded, but I think we've covered a certain amount, a number of things. Then there was this interesting report in 2012. Commissioned by the European Commission, and that's a more detailed look in who the culprits are and so on, but basically it was confirming the predictions of the Gartner report, the earlier Gartner report, but obviously with far more data and far greater analysis, okay? And I'm jotting down some numbers. On the left-hand side is China, actually. There's an A, not an E. The world's electricity consumption is of the order of 26,000 terawatt-hours per year. China eats up about a fifth of that. Then I mentioned there the EU report. And what's interesting is that in 2012, the electricity consumption to operate information technology represented the same amount of electricity as is consumed by Japan. So the whole electricity consumption of Japan equals, in 2012, the amount of energy consumed in ICT. Okay? And for today, the numbers we talk about are 1,600. Now, 1,600 terawatt hours, so it's like Japan plus Germany. Now, the thing is that when people look at these numbers, they sometimes include entertainment, and sometimes they don't, okay? Entertainment being televisions, audio systems, and so on. They're sometimes included, sometimes, so you get some discrepancies. Okay,
so I'm giving you kind of the big picture here. I'll skip that. And of course, industry has been looking at how savings can be made.
So there was an international consortium called Green Touch. It was driven by AT&T and Lucent and so on. A number of companies essentially were involved in this, and a number of universities. And they were saying, well, if you do this, you get that. If you do this, things are improving in this way and the other way. But the thing is, these things are not being done, okay? And furthermore, the consortium now is dead. It's gone.
So it's kind of interesting how these things go and how recommendations of this kind proceed. But okay, so what can we do? Okay, what can we do to make things, to take
keep things as much as possible under control. There is one very interesting thing, and I claim that governments are some of the biggest culprits in the game. Why? Because governments love selling bandwidth. What do they like to do? They sell, I don't know how many billion dollars, they sell a bunch of a frequency band. They auction these things out to telephone companies, and telephone companies, operators, come in and buy this, and they all create competing networks. So unfortunately, we are having a duplication of infrastructure. And that's why I say one easy way to improve things with respect to energy consumption is to share the infrastructure.
Share the infrastructure as much as possible. The old monopoly model, for instance, of telecommunications, but that doesn't go with the, liberal economy and the idea that governments need cash for their pet projects. So this is one problem we have. So sharing the infrastructure, consolidating the infrastructure. And what's interesting is that the only country I know of that is moving in this direction is China. So China has four, I think, mobile operators and has created an infrastructure company which will be working for the operators. So we'll be providing them the infrastructure, while the operators will compete and they will use software to share this infrastructure. The infrastructure itself will be partially run by a single company, which will optimize, obviously, because they will have costs that they want to minimize, whether it's electricity costs or infrastructure costs. So that's interesting. Another thing is that a lot of this energy consumption is due to useless software. So no software is useless, right? It may all have some use at some point, et cetera, but a lot of the computers we use, including our laptops, have a tremendous amount of software. Most of this software, we're not using. However, it's interacting with the supporters of the software, the organizations that have made it, and that have sold it, and so on, for updates. It's interacting for updates, or new versions, and so on. And indicating that it's there, questions of permission, questions of security. So all of this software is creating a lot of work on our laptops and on the internet. And that is something which is actually consuming energy and also needs to be taken a little bit in control. Now, questions of operating at optimal load, speed, power, etc. A lot of my the things I'll be talking about in a few minutes are oriented towards that. Then routing traffic to minimize energy. So there are huge amounts of traffic traveling around the internet, and you can actually, if you do the routing properly, you can actually save energy, and that's something else we'll be talking about. Okay? Energy-aware task allocations, dynamic sleep and wake, that's another thing we'll be talking about, and so on. So they're using renewable or scavenged energy. People are starting to talk about, for instance, the IoT. I haven't said anything about the IoT, but the IoT is going to create a lot of new mobile phones. Okay? Not really mobile phones, but these will be automatic sensors collecting data and perhaps having that trading role as well. And they will be using the internet, they'll be using the clouds, the cloud servers. So all of that is going to make things even worse unless we take some precautions. And of course, you can think about radical changes in technology, which some of the ideas we'll talk about are about that. Now, in effect, I think the next picture is a bit more useful. In effect, a lot of the things we do, we think about, for instance, wireless transmitters, but the wireless transmitter may have a few watts going up in the air, but will have 10 watts or more sitting there for processing. Okay? So a lot of our energy consumption is actually in digital processors, digital machines, whether we're doing communications or we're doing computing. So it's going to be these processors. And what happens is that with these processors, if they do nothing, they use energy. Now, things are getting a bit better, but not so much. So it's not unreasonable to consider that if your machine is on but not doing anything, it may be running at half of maximum power. Okay.
What would that include? That would include this, that would include the communication connectors, that would include the processors, the operating system, the exchange of messages, because this is connected, so it has to remain in contact with the system with which it is interconnected and so on. And then, so you
do have a high power level when you do nothing. Things are getting better with multiple core machines, but still not that great. And then, of course, as the load goes up, you will come to some maximum level of power consumption. And the red line then is some kind of efficiency metric related to this system. Okay. In my own, a lot of researchers like myself go through things as a learning experience. We don't, when we start on a problem, we're probably a few people who have started working on a particular problem. We don't know what the good problems are. Okay, so it's a learning experience. So in my own work, I started looking at energy-aware ad hoc networks. Then I looked at wired networks and so on. So a lot of the things that the sequence of research problems I've looked at are related to my own learning experience, which turned into papers, into projects, and so on, and to hopefully some useful results.
But I will now pick a few little points where some results will be presented. One interesting situation is when you consider a bunch of communication nodes that are talking to each other through wires. Okay? So you have a bunch of communication nodes, they're talking to each other through wires, but these communication nodes have three components. Okay? They have a processor. Why? Because if they're communicating, they have to store some data that they either receive or they would send. And this processor is going to connect the unit to whichever end user, human or mechanical or electronic or whatever, end user is making use of this communication device. Okay? Then you're going to have a transceiver, it's a transmitter, in fact, a transceiver. Except the transmission power usually is higher than the receiving power, but the power that you expend as an individual transceiver or receiving is much less than what you use for transmitting. So you're going to have transceivers, you'll have processor, transceivers, and energy sources. Okay. Now, suppose you have many of those and they're cooperating. Then the question is, how can I manage this system of, say, N transceivers so that the energy consumed per correctly received unit of data is minimized? Right? Not talking about power, I'm talking about energy. Why about energy? Because energy is increasing. So that's what we're looking at. So what we want to do is have all these folks communicating with each other. I assume they're cooperative, so they're not there to kind of knock each other out of the spectrum. They're cooperating. And they should be able to do this so that at the end of the day, the amount of energy they use, joules, not watts, joules they use, per correctly received unit, correctly, why? Because there are going to be errors. And again, if we speak in time, no one will hear them. Therefore, that's useless. So in this case, what is the voice level? The voice level is a transmission power, right? So the volume of voice corresponds to the transmission power of the transmitters. And you have all of these things. And you're looking at the efficiency. But the efficiency becomes interesting, efficiency being how much energy per unit of correctly received power. It becomes interesting because you can't just consider the transceiver itself. You also have to consider the processor. Let me just kind of show you a couple of examples, intuitive examples. First of all, suppose they're all shouting the highest possible pitch. Okay, they use very high power. What's going to happen? there's going to be a lot of interference. It's like if in a room, during a talk, everyone starts talking, no one understands each other, right? And therefore, the correctly received the data, whatever that may be, is very, very little, despite the huge amount of energy that's expended and the huge level of power. Okay? So that's bad news. So we don't want everyone to shout. We want everyone to be careful about how they modulate their voice. First point. Second point, if we have a very slow system, suppose it's running very, very slowly, okay, then, oh, that would be great, because the processors are running very slowly. As you know, power consumption of the processors increases their speed, right? Because it's digital switches that energy, that power, that energy is consumed. It's the integral of the switch, switching time, and on the power level during that time, voltage times V of t times I of t, integrated over that long interval of time when something is happening. So you're looking at that. But then the bad news is the transmission speed is going to be very small too, because the processing speed is small. And so then, so the packets arrive to be transmitted, they're slowly being transmitted. That's not very useful, because then you're going to have, again, your efficiency may be low, despite the fact that your power consumption is low, your energy simply because bit by bit, the time you spend doing this is going to be much longer. Okay? So it's not a totally trivial question to look at. And you're looking at again, as I was saying, number of bits transmitted per energy unit. And you can model this. You can build a mathematical model of the system we're talking about by looking at the size of the data that you're transmitting. You're looking at the speed at which you're transmitting. You're looking at the power consumption, which is a function of the speed at which this transmission and this processing is taking place. And you're looking at the power levels at the electronics, at the transmission, and in the storage. Because as the system slows down, you're going to have more time spent in queues, and therefore you're going to spend energy, power multiplied by time is energy, you're going to spend time in the queues as well. So all of that has to be integrated. Okay? So we're looking at the situation like that, and then you also have to consider the error probabilities. And when you consider the error probabilities, usually you say, well, the probability of correct reception, small f, is the probability of correct reception. It depends on the power with which the people you would like to hear are transmitting. Okay, so everyone else is transmitting a certain power. It depends on noise, which is perhaps an intrinsic aspect of the system, but it also depends on the interference. Okay? And of course, in all of these things, you can improve with coding. You can do clever things with coding, but at the end of the day, you're going to be interested in the ratio of the transmission power divided by the noise power and the interference power, plus the interference power. So you're going to have an error probability of that form, and then you can calculate the efficiency as number of effectively transmitted packets per energy unit, okay? And you can write it in this form, okay? But in this form, we're only looking at the power for the electronics and the power for the transmission. Okay, so we get that. And then you could say, well, I'd also like to look at, okay. And if you just try to solve that problem, you can actually you can prove that the optimal operating point is where the equation down there, the left-hand side equals the right-hand side, where the derivative with respect to its argument of the error probability, or rather the correct reception probability, you're looking at that, equals the terms on the right-hand side, which correspond to the parameters of the system. So you can model this and then do some analysis and get some results, okay? So if you do that, then you can look at things like, you know, I have n bits, not just one bit, but I have several bits, and you can also introduce error correction, error detection, all the usual things. And at the end of the day, what you get is that you come up with what it, with a value of the optimum power level that will minimize the energy consumed per correctly received data unit, whatever that data unit is. So you can get exact results using this kind of analysis.
Now, if you introduce the queuing times,
okay, then you can consider, you can use the mathematical analysis of queuing systems to determine how long your buffers will be, how many packets they will store, okay? And that will depend on the transmission speed, obviously. But not only on the transmission speed, it will also depend on the error probabilities, because the packets in a communication system are not removed from the sender queue until they are acknowledged, until the other side says, hey, I got the right packet, ready. So you get an ACK, and then you say, okay, now I can throw out this, my job is finished, I can throw it away. If you don't get an ACK, then your packet has to be rerouted. So it's like a service time that has to be rerouted, okay? So you can include that aspect of the problem as well, and you end up getting similar results. So that's nice. So let's move on to something else, okay? What I've talked about is the wireless world. So the wireless world, any problem actually that I'm talking about is not a closed question. It's just an aspect that is looked at, that is worth looking at. And you can generalize, you can look at other cases, you can look at cognitive radio in this context, and so on. There are lots of things to be done in these contexts. But what I showed you was one instance of a problem related to power, optimizing the power level so that you minimize the energy consumed per packet correctly received. Now, another interesting thing to look at is to look at servers, okay? Like your laptop, like the server in your lab, the server that supports the files in your lab or in your department or in university and so on. You look at these servers, and these servers will have I can show you pictures of this, perhaps, before I do calculations. Yeah, they will have characteristics of power consumption, okay, of power, as a function of load. So you can measure this, right? You can measure how much power they're consuming. How do you do that? Well, you stick some kind of watt meter on them, and as a function of their workload, you can see what the power consumption is. Now, this power consumption will be, as I said, will be workload dependent. And you can model this rather simply. You remember the first curve I showed you? There's a constant part, and then there's a second part which is linearly dependent on the load. And why would it be linearly dependent on the load? It's simply because with today's machines, as the load increases, you're turning on more cores, more processors. Okay? So when the machine is not quote-unquote doing anything, you just have perhaps one or two processors supporting the operating system and supporting the communication system and so on. And then as you ask it to execute tasks, to whatever they may be, your homework assignment or whatever, or your simulation, your MATLAB simulation, the number of cores active will increase, and you'll have a power consumption pi, which will have roughly this form, A and B being constants, okay? A is power consumption when there is no external load on the machine. So then you can say, well, in that case, what is the energy consumed per job? Okay? And you can say, well, that's fine. Suppose my job arrival rate is lambda. So I have lambda jobs arriving per unit time. Right? If I have lambda jobs arriving per unit time, the energy consumed per job is going to be my power divided. Power is joules per second, it's watts, joules per second. And I'm going to divide that by the arrival rate, jobs per second. And I divide joules per second by jobs per second, I get joules per job, right? So here, I will get then joules per job. And I see that it's A over lambda plus B. Now this utilization, there's a result in queuing theory that's which is very robust and it doesn't depend very much on the statistics of the arrival and service times. It's that the utilization
is equal to the arrival rate multiplied by the average service rate. Okay? So you use that, and you say, well, joules per jump is going to be A over lambda times B times the average service rate, which, in fact, is an intuitive form, okay, reassuring intuitive form. I skip this, and I get there. Okay? Now, when I get there, I can say, well, my cost function is not just about energy. I'm not just interested in minimizing energy. I have a job to do, okay? I have jobs to do. I have a service to render. So I'm going to look at two things. I'm going to look on the left-hand side at the average response time of jobs, okay? On the right-hand side, I'm going to look at energy. Now, the average response time of jobs is what brings, for instance, a data center money. If you keep your average response time low, you're respecting your commitments to your customers. If you violate these commitments, your response time is very high, you may have to do this to work for free. Okay? So it's quite natural to think that you're going to have a cost function. I've put the simplest form, which is a linear combination of response time and energy. Okay, but it can be a bit more complicated than that. So you have this kind of cost function, and then you're interested in optimizing this cost function. Well, what are the parameters that you can use? Well, the users impose upon you the average service time. It's their characteristic. You can't do anything about this. What you can do is accept a certain fraction of them. Okay? So you can play with the lambda. You can tune your load. You can decide to tune your load to say, well, this system will operate. I can't do everything. I'm going to operate at some kind of optimum level where I minimize my cost function. And I can play with the lambda, with the average arrival time of jobs. Now, what's interesting is this is a measurement, okay, on a real machine. And what you have here is the average response time as a function of the load, right? So the blue dots are the measurements. The green line are the theory given by the formula. So it's what this says is that, well, the theory and the measurements are not too far off. So you have something which is reasonable. Furthermore, you can look at the other part of the cost function, which is the energy consumption per job, okay? And you can look at it again as a function of load, and again, the green line is what was in the theory, and the blue dots are what are in the measurements. Okay, so again, you say, well, that's not too far off, seems to be reasonable. And then, based on this, you can tell yourself, well, since this formula is more or less robust with respect to what we observe in reality, we're going to choose the best operating point, the best load for the system. Okay? And the best load turns out to be this given by this formula, which is very intuitive. A, large A, is the power level consumed when the machine is idle. Right? Small a is the importance I give to the response time. Small b is the importance I give to my energy consumption. Okay? And the formula says that if I know A and small b and small a, then I know where I should be operating my system, what my best operating point is. Now, rho is arrival rate multiplied by average response time. So I have to factor that in, and I say this is the kind of level of operation that I want. So this gives you a simple way of looking at things, and then you can say, well, how does this fit the measurements? And again, you look at different situations, different machines, and you see that the optimum that you find using the theory, which is the minimum point on the solid lines, really would be what you would expect, what you'd find also roughly in a system that you're measuring. Okay. However, there are other interesting questions which arise, which is, okay, now I have one machine, and I decide which is its operating point so that I minimize this cost function, which is on the one hand, I have the response time involved in service, on the other hand, I have the energy consumption. Okay? You could say, well, now I'm going to have many machines, because I have a substantial workload, I'm going to have many machines, and my decision is going to be to share the workload. How do I share the workload among many different machines?
Now, all these machines are going to get the same workload that you're sharing. However, so the jobs all have the same statistics. However, the machines will have different speeds, right? And they will have different large A's and large B's, okay? The only thing that will be the same is a small A and a small B. Small A is how important is response time, small B is how important is energy consumption. So you're going to have things like that, and you can then determine
what is the optimum way you should be sharing load among the machines. Okay?
So you have the other problem, oh, I have this, these machines, servers in my data center, I have multiple servers, you're doing these Google things, they're coming into the servers, and the server, and when the data center has to decide how it's going to share this workload so that it does the best compromise between energy and quality of service. Okay? So that is something that you get, again, mathematically.
You can analyze mathematically and obtain results. And then you have the on-off problem,
okay? So the other question that you have is, of course, you all know machines turn themselves off, right? They're not used. That's the good news. The bad news, actually, is that turning on and off the machine itself consumes energy. Why is that? Simple. You have to save the state. You have the state say, create a safe copy of whatever you have. You either do it all the time, which can be energy, you know, can will increase anyway your the load on the machine, or you can do it when you are getting ready to go to sleep, to the machine to sleep. So it turns out that going to sleep and waking up is itself energy bores. Okay?
And what's being done here is looking at the optimum,
how should I optimally turn things on and off? Okay, that question. And what you see on the left-hand side, upper level, it's system resuming. Okay, as a system resumes, for a substantial number of seconds, this is a server, okay, it's not your laptop, but it's a server, for a substantial number, and of course it will depend on how much data the server is storing, how many programs it has, and so on. It's not kind of a universal value. But what you see is that for about 40 to 50 seconds, perhaps a little bit more, the server is running at max power. Okay, until it's on again. So you turn it on, it wakes up, it has to run very hard to kind of bring things into live memory, gets running, and so on. And similarly, when it's hibernating, again, it has to work very hard to hibernate. Okay. It works very hard to go to sleep, works very hard to wake up, so there is a substantial overhead. And the questions we raised about, you know, optimal operating points and so on, they come again in this context, when you include the fact that things have to wake up and sleep.
So I'll pass on a few things and talk just a little bit about networks.
So in my lab, I have, depending on how many machines are, how many servers, how many routers are broken or not broken, okay, depending on the day. Obviously, I buy them. After a while, they start dying, and then I replace the ones that are dead and so on, because I don't get maintenance contracts. So I have about 40 to 50 routers lying around in my lab. And in these experiments, we were doing kind of something we did quite a few years ago. We were interested in seeing whether it made sense to turn routers on and off. Okay, before I showed you that turning things on and off is expensive in terms of overhead. And one thing you can say, well, depending on the traffic of the network, I'm going to turn certain routers on and off. And basically the answer was, it wasn't a good idea. But you can see up there what's going on when just one on the left-hand corner up there, you're seeing above the number of routers that are on, and you see the number on the right-hand side. Okay, you see that at that time we were working with something like 40 odd routers. The experiment was running 40 odd routers, and we have a long period when they're on, a long period when that router, one router is off, and so on. And it has a substantial impact on response time, okay, on the delay. So you have the step function effect on the delay, which tells you that, you know, users are going to perceive problems. And you're also going to see, as you look down there on the second little square, the one in the middle, what you see is peaks of loss, packet losses. So you see peaks of packet losses. Now, packet losses are bad news in two ways. One is the packet is lost, but the other bad news, the really bad news, is if you're going to return them. Okay? Because the protocol expects you to deliver them reliably. So you're going to do the job twice, if not more times. So you have peaks of packet losses, and down there you have something else, which is what communication people call jitter. So you see the jitter effect, and the jitter says, well, the jitter wasn't that bad. The jitter was okay, generally, but the losses were unpleasant, okay, and the response times were unpleasant. So we looked at things like that to see whether it made sense, and the conclusion was, I mean, it also pushes you to understanding why networks are generally always up. Turning things on and off introduces perturbation to the system because they have to reroute and so on. The routing tables have to be propagated, so it doesn't make it a sensible thing to do. While, you know, on a server you might do it, on a network you probably wouldn't do it. Okay, and these curves here, just for you to see some real data, are power consumption against traffic in packets per second. And you see how load-dependent the power consumption is in these routers, which tells you that if you could smooth the traffic across the network so that everyone shares in some sense the traffic, then the power consumption would go down, and therefore the energy consumption in the global time would go down as well. Okay? So you see that, and that's exactly what we did. We actually designed a protocol we call this the energy-aware routing protocol. We built a protocol that would do the following thing, more or less. Okay? As long as a path, a traffic flow, from A to B, not a path, but a traffic flow, so A is talking to B, right? So the network is composed of many of these pairs, A talking to B, C talking to F, et cetera, et cetera. And they're all connected to a multi-hop network. So what we tried to do was to say, okay, as long as delay is not too big, always try to choose the path where you're going to consume the least energy. Okay? And per packet. And how do you estimate that? Well, you know what the power consumption is at each of the routers. Okay? Power consumption times time is going to be the energy consumed at that router. And if my packet is traveling through, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, routers, so its own share of the energy consumption is going to be, again, the total energy consumption divided by the number of packets that have gone through during that time. Okay? So we're using that kind of heuristic, and we came up with essentially this is the average power consumption across the network, not for one, but across the network. And of course, we looked at this under different load conditions, and we also looked at the average delay. And what we saw was that, you know, we can, if we just work towards optimum delay, then we have, say, delays of the order of less than 30 milliseconds. If, on the other hand, we take the route that I described, which is we try to optimize energy as long as delay is not too high, then we have much higher delays. Okay, so we're trading off quality of service against energy consumption again. So this was another piece of work that we did. More of that, and there are lots of interesting aspects to this work. Okay, I'm jumping from one topic to the other, and now jumping to something a bit different, which is related also to how much time I have left. And this here, the idea is, the general idea is, can we manage, suppose you have a large network of consumers represented, say, by computer systems, internet nodes, and so on. So you have this large community of consumers, and you have sources of energy. And actually, when I say sources of energy, you may have multiple sources of energy, even though they may not, none of them may be renewable, they may have different prices. We have many different for instance, some energy is coming from a coal plant. You need to use it, but you don't want to use too much of it. Some other is coming from a nuclear plant, depending on how you feel. If you're in France, you think that this is great, and then you tend to use that. Incidentally, the country in the world that has the lowest CO2 impact electricity is obviously France. Okay, it's under 100 grams per kilowatt hour. While if you look at, the US, it's more like 400 because they use a lot of coal and so on. So anyway, so
you're trying to look at a situation where you're flexibly flowing energy
towards consumers.
And also, you use storage, which actually, when you're dealing with computer systems, is not that surprising,
because a lot of computer systems have, if they have any importance at all, like their router or something, they will have uninterruptible power supplies, which will include that. Okay. So we're looking at systems like that,
and we're modeling this. I won't go into the details and not show you too many formulas and so on, but basically, this is a complicated queuing network where you have, on the one hand, you have energy flows and batteries.
Batteries, you can think of them as queues, ways where energy waits. Okay? And then you have queues of work, like your router. Okay? And you can play the amount of energy against the amount of work that you back up. You slow down the operation of your router, its own queue increases. On the other hand, the queue increases, which is bad. On the other hand, less energy is consumed and so on. So you can play these things off and dynamically manage a system like that.
And you can develop mathematical models which represent these kinds of systems. Okay? So I'll kind of float through that. Anyone interested? There's just a paper, fairly recent paper, in 2016 in the journal, IEEE journal called Access.
It's an online, it's an open access journal, it's called IEEE Access. Have a look there. It's a paper we published recently on energy packet networks. That's the energy packet network, blah, blah, blah. So it's something about that. Have a look at that.
So the kinds of questions you can answer with these models is, for instance, consider this situation.
Suppose you have a remote astronomical observatory. Okay, I'm sure that people here in the astronomy department will be very happy about this. So you have this remote astronomical observatory. Basically, what is it? It's a radio it's a sensor, right? It's a big sensor which uses a lot of energy. However, there's a place where the astronomers sit. Sometimes that needs to be air conditioned. It's a remote place, so it needs some security to protect against the kangaroos. So there's a security network around the thing, so the kangaroos can get in and the snakes as well. So you have a system like that, and each of these subsystems, whether it's air conditioning or the whether it's the air conditioning security system or the sensor, the radio, the passive or active receiver, and so on. So you have all of that. There's going to be communications, there's going to be perhaps some computing going on. So all of these things can be represented by a dynamical interaction with the energy system. And the energy system itself can use photovoltaic, can use wind, and there can be some connection to the grid as well, and you have, of course, preferences. And you can define utility functions. For instance, you can say, well, I would like to, my backlog of work, not to be too high, but on the other hand, I would like to maintain reserve energy in the batteries in case of an emergency. So this creates a utility function. You can dispatch your energy so that you establish a compromise between different objectives. Okay? So these
models can help you address such questions. I'll talk about one last, then there are interesting random walk problems associated with such systems, and random walks are what happens if you've had too many beers and are walking around the streets of Newcastle and you kind of start developing a random walk. So Okay, let me just talk about one last thing.
And, okay, so if we want to be really radical, right, all the things I've talked about are at least things where you can expect to save, say, half of the energy at best. Suppose you want to save 99% of the energy, what you need, right? In that case, either you shut down all your operations and you'll be just fine, or you have to change your technology radically. And one possibility, this is data about CMOS, CMOS technology. If you look at switching times of CMOS circuits, basically there's something you can't do anything about, and that's leakage currents. Okay, and they're going to be there, and they're going to heat the device. They're there. But the other thing you can do, and of course, as things get smaller, the leakage currents can get worse, right? Because the insulators are not as good insulators as they used to be. As things get smaller. But as the other thing you can look at is your rise times and fall times for your digital circuits, the rise and fall times. And you can say, well, if I'm on or off, there's just a leakage current. If I'm moving up or down, then I'm also expanding electrons to do the switching, right? And if you can actually count the number of electrons, how? You just look at the currents, and you look at the rise and fall times. And you see that basically we are in the business with CMOS today, the best technology, we're in the business of expanding, of using up, or kind of, you don't use them up because they stay there, they stay somewhere, but we're using up 50,000 to 100,000 electrons per switch, okay, per bit, up, down, right? So this is what CMOS does. Your 100,000 electrons is a ballpark figure. Now the question is, wouldn't it be great if we could do things with just a few bits? So each individual, just a few electrons. So each, for instance, individual bit would be carried by one electron. Now, is there something in an electron that can allow you to do that physically? Yes, the answer is you have spin. So spin is magnetic property of the electron. The electron is going around, moving around. As it moves around, it becomes a current. Once you have a current, a rotating current, you have a field. Yeah. And that is actually how the magnets we use are built, right? They're made up of particles that have spins. So the idea would be to exploit spins. But when you start exploiting spins, and again, anyone interested, have a look at a paper that appeared last year, in the IEEE transactions on emerging topics in computing called communicating with spins. And then the question is,
the questions that you come up with is, what are the sources of error? Okay, what would be, if you wish, the Achilles heel?
What is going to make this idea stumble? Okay. And it turns out that there are several things that you have to worry about. One of the things you have to worry about is, again, the thermal effect, energy being absorbed by the electron. The thermal effect, it will vibrate more, and the spin gets disorganized. It's like if you buy a nice magnet, okay, you put it in the oven, you really warm it up, and then you take it out, and you waste your money, right? So the magnet is gone. So it's exactly the same thing. You disorganize the system, and later on, too bad, it's lost. So the first thing that you have to worry about is this. But the second thing you have to worry about is the fact that spins tend to be influenced by each other. It's like a social network. Okay, and depending on how close the particles are, they will either align themselves against their side, as you'd expect, you know, faction, they're a bit further away, they will align themselves in the same direction. So it's like a social network where you listen to people, and so you have the thermal effect, you have the social network effect, and then you have something else which is called entanglement, which is that particles which have been in the same place will tend to have oppositely correlated properties, spins,
and that they will carry this property for something like 30 microseconds. So for a certain time, they will keep on with this property called entanglement. Now, how does entanglement impact? It's good if these particles remain in the same place, because if one is perturbed by noise, the other one will not. It's bad if they end up in different places, because if one is perturbed by noise, the other one will switch it off. Okay, so you'll double up the error rates. So basically, the paper in question does the analysis of this, okay, and suggests a, let me just show you a picture. Where's my picture? Yeah, it's coming. And suggests a detector, what I call a bipolar detector, that can reduce the error rates associated with particles. So it's some kind of the way you do detection of spins is again through a magnetic field. So the particles go through a field, and they traverse the field. If they're aligned with the field, the field is not perturbed. If they are counter-aligned with the field, then the field will be perturbed. That's how you can measure what the polarity is. So the idea is to use two complementary detectors to minimize the probability the probability of error, of the impact of error. Anyway, so that's a kind of thing. And then there's actually another paper as well where I analyze more particularly the, it just appeared in June, I think, where I align more particularly the stabilizing effect of spins, of connections. Now, here is the theorem. Now, this is a theorem. The theorem says, suppose you have a collection of particles. They come in into a place, some location, where there is a very, very weak directional field. Okay. So, how does this directional field operate? It operates in the following way. If everyone is aligned with a field, if everyone has the same opinion as this field, okay, then this field will be turned off. Okay. Now, if all but one, all of them are aligned, if at least one is aligned in an opposite direction, then the field turns itself on again. So it's kind of a transient field. And the result says that in the limit, again, as time tends to infinity, they all align in the same direction. So you can think of this as a way to encode and also as a way to analyze the effect of perturbations on the spins. That's, I guess, as far as I will get today, since I'm already about 10 minutes over my time, and there was also an issue of temperature there, which I kind of glossed over. So upcoming challenges,
obviously we need information technology, okay? However, the energy consumption is going up, CO2 impact is going up, and we really need to find ways to put this process in some level of perspective and control. We can't keep on just accepting that things will get worse. Okay, and we can do various things. One is look at the operating points of the systems, the workload sharing aspects, the turning on and off aspects, and we can also look at what would happen if we did radical changes in technologies. And one of the radical changes I have not talked about is the idea that neuromorphic architectures, computer architectures, would potentially have a much lower energy consumption. Okay, there's a whole piece of work going on around the world on exploiting or thinking about that idea. So that's one more thing that's worth considering. While you remain with the current technology, CMOS, etc., etc., you change the way you compute, and you use
neuronal type architecture, which means that your computation is not the way you do it anymore. You have to reprogram the system. So again, it's a radical change that uses current technologies. And that's another potential way of reducing energy consumption.
I think I'll stop there and thank you all.